program. I now welcome a lecture, a joint lecture from Kushewe and Kot Fiore. The title of the presentation is The Zimbabwean Healthcare System. So we'll give them a chance to go through their presentation, their lecture, and then we'll open it up for discussion. And please try and keep your questions short when the time comes, okay?
So there is a small announcement, just to find out. For lunch, we have some starches, rice and potatoes. But let's see by raise of hands, how many would also want some sada? So that we see how big the pot should be. The pot of sada, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 men, 6. Did I qualify five men?
Yeah.
I know why.
Sada for men.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for your text.
Thank you. Please allow me to abuse this opportunity. I'm supposed to get straight into the presentation, but I also feel perhaps I should say a sentence or two on the, about the Department of Economic History, which is partnered with BRTI. This is a fairly young department, having been established in 1988, thereabouts. And it has a very interesting history because it is evolving from the history department, or it is developing from the history department. And you have the likes of Dr. Mtisi, I think, and others who have developed a way of perceiving and interpreting historical processes. These are people who are interested largely at understanding or using economic lenses to appreciate historical processes. We, at least as we inherit from them, a legacy of basically analyzing things or emphasizing issues of economic importance. The belief being that, you know, even before you think about going to church, a simple example, sometimes your stomach takes a priority, right? You want to be fed, or at least you go to that church thinking you will be fed material, I think. You talk of prosperity, you talk of being blessed, which is a polite way of saying being rich or something to that effect. But this may not necessarily be correct, but the thinking is that if you want to understand how society operates and how things are developed or unfold, we could be better placed in so doing by looking at economic processes. So we are interested in issues to do with labor, agrarian development, we are interested in manufacturing, we are interested in, if it comes to health, we actually have a cost of medical health. Who funds and how is that our health sector funded, and how does it impact, what is the relationship with economic development, etc, etc. So we look at various issues, social, economic, political, but from an economic standpoint. And what we've done is we are expanding the department. Soon we are likely to introduce a BA in sustainable development, sustainable economic development, if things go to plan. We are networked largely internationally, but we are working, as you can see now, with BRTI, at having more local kind of relations. At this point, we have an MOU with the Gurion University, Lund University, Stellenbosch recently, and we've had opportunities to operationalize this MOUs in various ways, exchange programs largely of lecturers, but we are looking at ways of extending that to also students, and we have been doing some applications and processes in that direction. And we are excited about our economic history, a new program which has so many areas of focus that range from labor issues, food security, gender and labor markets, etc., etc. And here we are now experimenting, enjoying, I should say, with the medical world. On that note, please allow me to switch to the more serious business of the day. Our task here is to provide a context, and being historians, or more specifically economic historians, we want to understand the health sector as it evolved. And this is basically the task we have with Dr. Owe. And what we're trying to do is provide a context within which HIV/AIDS develops. And of course, when Caroline comes in, she will then say a lot about how we then respond to, as a nation and as a society, to HIV/AIDS. And that response is informed by many things, in part by the socio-economic context of this health sector. So I will be looking at the first decade, which by now the students are familiar with, that in the economics of Zimbabwe, the first decade, which is sometimes called a socialist decade, alright, where you what some scholars call socialist rhetoric. And the health sector is developing within that context, where we have got independence and people are trying to address inequalities that are coming with colonialism. And in the process, you begin to see a number of policies that come into place. I'll quickly run through my slides. By way of intro, perhaps by way of starting, let me just tell you the structure of that presentation. I will look at the first decade of independence, which is marked by strides and inroads in improving the health of Zimbabweans. This is basically hinged on addressing colonial imbalances. I'll say more about that. Then, of course, the second part of that presentation will demonstrate that despite some gains, they did remain some kind of challenges in the health sector. And finally, I will demonstrate that even as we have something positive, or at least a lot of positive things to say, perhaps comparatively relative to the later period, I still would argue here that when it comes to HIV/AIDS, the state was ill prepared, let alone able to handle the outbreak. All right, and of course, my introduction. We all know that health is actually a right, which is enshrined in the UN's Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and of course the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, among others. So this is something that is agreed, at least internationally and locally, that health is, and of course every person has the right to the highest attainable standard of physical and mental health without discrimination, which includes access to adequate health care, nutrition, sanitation, clean water, and occupational health. Now, these fundamentals also help inform the first decade. And of course, it's common knowledge that there's a two-way relationship between health and economic development, and also or stroke poverty. And of course, I was going to ask students about that two-way relationship, but I think it's an obvious thing. When an economy is healthy, all right, you have a better opportunity or you are better able to handle or to deal with health outbreaks, right? And also, a healthy nation is able to contribute positively to development. So there's a two-way relationship in this. And of course, this is the subject of our course medical history that is taught at the master's level. Now, the dominant health problems that were inherited in the new government, they included nutritional deficiencies, all right, communicable diseases, and inadequate access to reproductive health services. And these problems were tilted against communal areas. This is mostly where you had these challenges, all right? where less than 10% of the population was covered, yet in urban areas there was 100% coverage of safe drinking water and immunization and waste disposal. Now, this can easily be explained in terms of the social economic engineering of the colonial state, where the urban space is largely reserved for the white population, while the communal spaces, the reserves, if you want, and of course other spaces like African beaches areas were reserved for Africans. And we had scholars from the department, Glenn, for example. I remember being his research assistant, writing a thesis on Danga, right, case study from its onset, I think around 1912, thereabout, through and through to the 50s. And what we see from those that kind of research is a story of neglect and negligence, and even when they do engage eventually, it's slightly out of the recognition that diseases know, they know no boundaries, right? The race, gender, etc., etc. Right? If I just cough here, I'm sure Anat would catch a cold as well. All right. So after that realization, you begin to see the involvement of the colonial state from that perspective, and that even informs the extent and degree to which they are going to be involved. Get it? So when it comes to independence, there's limited investment when compared to the urban spaces. And even in the urban spaces, what is even pushing them to even involve themselves with Africans, you know, is what is so-called sanitation syndrome, so to speak. This obsession with sanitation and so forth among Africans is largely driven by selfish ends, so to speak, because these Africans will still come to work at your workplace and they will affect. So this is the context within which Africans are receiving help. And this is well documented in colonial archives. And this is the business in our department to actually provide such evidence. But so an independence with resources that are skewed largely against the African population, which is right in the communal area. So this is what is happening, right? And we have evidence. Now that it is me presenting, I had to find a proper thing.
My stick is
fine. So, you see, this is central, right? Hospital, general, district, rural. And you can see here, in terms of nursing, doctors, beds, even when, and even when it comes to expenditure, right? And we're talking of four here, but in terms of population of beds, the ratio there, right? So there's this skewed, this is at night, there's this skewed or kind of disadvantaged distribution of resources in terms of hospitals. So this context is critical because it helps you appreciate the response of the government, right? It means this huge drive that it takes. Even this adoption of that socialist rhetoric is informed in part by this kind of background. And you can say a lot about this, right? So you see the government now adopting this equity in health kind of policy. So it was a well-articulated vision which actually emphasized need rather than ability. So if there's a need, we address the need, right? Ability to pay is secondary, right? So it is this within this context that you then have the development of health for all, education for all, because we are going for the need rather than ability to pay, right? And of course, you then have this encapsulated in a normal policy of health for all by the year 2000. So then you begin to also see the government involved heavily in primary health care, where in 1992 the Minister of Health adopted primary health care as the strategy to address health inequalities, achieve integration, and improve access to health services. And of course, this involved, once again, an effort to reallocate resources from central and general hospitals to district hospitals, clinics, and community outreach services. This perhaps began the roots of what we are now having, or at least provided the framework within which efforts to deal with other diseases such as HIV AIDS were then deployed. So you have, for example, the case study that we're going to be dealing with in Chinamoyo, where they are already using existing structures to deal with the outbreak. Right? These structures have their roots to this period. Right? The health sector's focus was on the predestined deserved rural areas to which it extended health, infrastructure, training, deployment of greater numbers of health workers, and the development of health management systems. And of course, there was tremendous progress, right? As a result of government intervention in primary health, preventative and health and preventive health, the infant mortality rate dropped from 90,000 in 1980 to 53,000 by 1988, and child immunization coverage rose from 25% to 80% in the same period. And the prevalence of malnutrition dropped over the same period from 22% to 12%. And during this period, it is actually argued that Zimbabwe experienced the most rapid improvement in health, nutrition, and demographic indicators. So yes, we are seeing a lot of interesting and very, very remarkable improvement. And the same can be said of even the seventh delivery, where a model was introduced in Independence that actually focused on public health infrastructure, extended programs of immunization, accelerated training of health professionals. I know my mother, for example, was one of those beneficiaries of this accelerated training of health professionals, right? And she would tell us of so many kind of opportunities and incentives that would be in place to encourage people to upgrade and so forth and so forth. And this was happening since independence. In compliance with this delivered model, the share of health expenditure during the 1980s was maintained at over 5% of total government expenditure, except during the years of droughts. I was too young to remember that, but I'm sure some of us here can tell us more about that drought. Right? Then from 1980 to 1980, health expenditure rose by 94% in real terms and 48% in real per capita terms. And as a percentage of GDP, health expenditure increased from 2.2% to 3% by 1989. The implications were that the health sector witnessed the use of much positive strides. This is interesting, all right? And this is very, very positive. I'm not sure if we have a similar story from structural adjustment to today, but at least soon after independence we can boast of such. In terms of human capital, I just insinuated on this. The government is initiating a number of strategies to increase the health sector workforce, and I'm sure some of us here are very familiar with these processes and experiences. Godfrey, what's happening to your computer? It's telling me battery low. Sorry. It's connected. Actually, it reminds me, you know the story of this gentleman who, now that we're talking about medical issues, who pulled out a life support system on an individual to charge his phone. Yeah? You know the joke? Yes. And this is, it looks like I'm seeing a phone here being charged. So please, do not tamper with life support system here. So there were these huge strides in terms of human capital. You had increased intake of existing training schools and building multi-disciplinary training schools. So a number of training schools are being built. Various programs were also initiated to upgrade the skills of nurses and environmental health technicians, and the curriculum of doctors and nurses were changed and then the new focus on primary health care. Now, this is critical because when HIV is then comes into the picture. It comes in a form where supposedly, we are in a fairly advanced state to, or we're supposed to be in a fairly advanced state to handle it better, all right? Or perhaps, if I were a prophet, I would want to know what would have happened if HIV/AIDS was discovered in the absence of such. Perhaps things could have been worse. Now, perhaps as I round down, this is not just a story of euphoria and success. There were challenges that we faced, and the critical area of state failure and public delivery during the first decade of Indonesia's absence of adequate institutional and political capacity to push the policy agenda of equality in health. This may also have sort of equity in health. This may also be related to what that entailed financially, all right? Because if you want to say health for all, education for all, it is, what does that mean to the fiscus of the country, all right? It's no surprise that in the 90s, the country is bankrupt and knocking at the doors of IMF. And of course, we are going into a liberal era. So, you could link to a certain extent these challenges in terms of its financial offers to the policy that had been adopted. So the implementation of different policies in health were challenged by several trends and features of the healthcare system, which included reductions in allocations to local authorities. These reductions were largely related to the drought era, especially which I made reference to. But if you want, but this has not been, this is probably not verified, but I am just using common sense. There must have been a lot of investment in the army in that period as well, given that there were these efforts to deal with so-called dissidents, etc. And I suspect the army may have also drained certain coffers. And normally, as we study, normally when you have a very huge military budget, it also compromises on other important or significant areas of development of investment. So this is just purely a conjecture. All right. So there was increasing pressure for fees, people to pay fees, right? Coming from private medical center to say this is unsustainable, people just come walking the hospital and not pay. And of course, continued concentration of financial higher cost manpower and other resources within urban. So even as we made efforts to expand beyond the urban spaces, the reality on the ground was that there was still continued investment, concentration, attention to urban spaces in terms of healthcare services. And the lack of effective functioning of the referral system. This should be my second from last, my penultimate slide. The first AIDS case was reported, at least from my source, in 1985, right? With respect to Zimbabwe, the first official AIDS case was reported, also the so-called reputation. In the same year, it was discovered that 2% of the blood donated to the blood transfusion service was infected by HIV. This led to the implementation of blood screening in June 1985. By 1990, the prevalence rate among those aged between 15 and 45 was 16.5%. The same year, it was estimated that over 500 people were dying weekly. Okay, now see this progression. The number of weekly deaths had risen to 1,921 by 1997. I'm not going to mention, make reference to the numbers that we already been, that they've already been, which are a far cry, and demonstrate this huge, right? While the prevalence level had risen to 25.8%. By 1998, the incredibility of HIV/AIDS was an accepted fact and part of the reason why the epidemic it led to a global panic. So this is just to provide a context of how HIV comes into the picture. The responses of the state, the responses of the society, it is leave that to Caroline. But it is interesting that this is happening at a time when we have structures in place, right, which we can use, but they are not exploited to their maximum because of what Caroline is going to tell us, the actual reaction or responses from the state. In terms of closing remarks, it is interesting to know that despite the noted expanding and relatively impressive health progress in the health sector, this did not help prevent or contain the spread of HIV virus. What follows is the story of Zimbabwean health sector as it went through some unparalleled, socioeconomic experiences. And these are the sources that I used for that presentation. Thank you very much.